It's Torah talk. It's Torah talk. It's Torah talk. It's Torah talk.
What is my name? What is my son's name?
That's a real.
It's Torah talk.
We are witnesses and watchmen of Torah.
Welcome to Torah Talk, a Torah Institute podcast.
Torah just means instruction in Hebrew. At Torah Talk, we will make straight the ways of Yahuwah and discuss the simple truths of Scripture so that even you can understand and get all the juicy life hidden within the pages of Yahuwah's Torah. Welcome to Torah Talk with Lew White and Mark Davidson.
It's the Torah Zone.
Gonna need the oil to meet the bridegroom. Yahusha is coming.
coming soon. Oh, lamp of light, we're gonna be burning through the midnight. Oh, lamp of light, Yahusha is keeping us out of the strife. Oh, lamp of light, the Torah will keep us shining so bright. Lamp of light, we're gonna need the oil to meet the bridegroom. Yahusha is coming soon. Of light, we're gonna be burning through the midnight. Lamp of light, Yahusha is keeping us out of the strife. Oh, lamp of light, the Torah will keep us shining so bright. Lamp of light, we're gonna need the oil to meet the bridegroom. Yahusha is coming soon.
Hey.
Hey, good morning, brother. How are you?
Good evening. How are you?
Yeah, good. Shabbat shalom, mate.
Yes, it's still Sabbath. Yeah, it's the very end.
Yep.
Well, how are you?
Yeah, very good. Very good. Got up a little bit earlier today. The kids woke me up, so I'm a bit more fresher.
Yeah.
Mm.
Did you get my email just a couple hours ago?
Oh, no. I haven't checked the emails yet.
Oh, okay. I just sent you a couple of pictures. This is about a 7.5 inch wide.
Let me say hello first.
Oh, say hello.
Hey, how are you doing?
How are you, sister?
Hey. Love you.
How you doing?
Just fine. It's good to see you.
Chilling out on the Sabbath?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Wonderful.
I had a chance to just to upload these to you. This is a little sticker, adhesive if you peel it off, and it's waterproof. It says, love me and keep my commandments. This is only the banner we just had made is it's double sided and it's really wide. It's like 7 feet wide, and it's getting installed below our sign at Taurus. Mm. This is the other one.
Ooh,
the universe didn't create itself.
Yeah.
Anyway, nice little things. People like to put things on their bumper stickers, on their cars, and. Mm. You know, and just drive down the road and have some sort of a witness to people, you know.
Mm. Yeah, they're great. Nice and bright colors. And
oh, yeah, they're beautiful. Mm. Yeah. And they just arrived yesterday. So. Mm.
Fantastic. You get the people that do your books to do them, do you?
Actually, yes. It was the same outfit down in Nashville. They're about 2.5 to 3 hour drive away from us. Mm. And they just shipped these up yesterday. We received them yesterday.
Mm.
Those are real nice. But I had a chance to look over the, you know, the materials on the lamp, you know, and that's a very important subject, you know.
Mm.
That's something that speaks of our vessel, you know. Mm. And so we can dive into that. Yeah. The code word, though, the lamp, refers to our heart, our inner spirit, and that is also like the vessel that Yahusha refers to as the wineskin.
Mm.
And the new wine, of course, is the new teachings, you know, that he has to bring to us. And the old wine is, of course, referring to the traditions of men.
Mm.
So people miss the meaning of that because they're not really aware of it in Christianity that much.
Mm.
But in the context of what he was talking about, the Pharisees and the scribes came to him and they said, what's going on? Why are you not fasting like Yehuchanan's servants or his disciples? Because, see, they looked at Yahusha as a continuation of Yehuchanan the Immerser, mm. or John the Baptist, his teachings, and they were seeing a difference, you know, between the way Yehuchanan's disciples acted and the way his disciples acted. He says, well, the bridegroom's friends are not going to have to fast while the bridegroom's with them.
Mm.
But and then he went on to say he was talking to them in code about wine and wineskins. And the wineskins he was talking about, you don't put new wine into old wineskins. In other words, you have to become a new creation of him to receive the new wine. And the new wine, of course, is the word of Yahuwah, his name and his word. And all they had to in their wineskins was the bloated old wine that they considered was good enough. In fact, it was better because it was already loaded in. And they had all this history behind them. But it, all it was men's traditions. You see, and that's what we have in our hearts when we're raised in a religion. We're taught the old wine of that religion, whatever it be. You know, it could be a pagan religion or a mixture of pagan religions with Yahuwah's words. And that's what Christianity really has turned into. So what we have to understand in this study is that we're going to have to figure out what the lamp is and what the oil is, you know, because those are key to understanding what we have to understand. Mm. Where would you want to begin?
Oh, well, that's why it's, I was just thinking then, that's why it's so important to the steps, repentance and immersion, because that's how you become a new wineskin, isn't it?
Yeah.
You can't just go into this movement, apparent, you know, this movement and learn all the knowledge if you haven't been transformed, like immersed.
Yeah, and a lot of people get bogged down in knowledge and they forget that the objective of any knowledge is to love one another, to love Yahuwah and love one another. And when we get aside from that, we start feeling like, well, you don't feel the same way I do about a little detail. The love leaves quickly, you know. And we will do things differently. We actually will. Because, you know, there was a gentleman that emailed me this past week from Australia. And he said, what's going on? You're saying these things that I don't believe. You know, like the circumcising our male children at the eighth day.
That was interesting, That was really nicely put, the way you did that. Like, really loving and yet really... just clear.
Well, yeah, you know, technically, we're supposed to do what... That's the dog. We're supposed to do everything that Yahusha did as an example. And he didn't need to be immersed, but he was immersed, you know. Yeah. But he also was circumcised on the eighth day. And if he wasn't circumcised, I mean, we could easily say, well, we don't have to do that either. But then, you know, if you're an older male... and you're outside the 8 days, and you just didn't know, you know, because most people don't know, you know, then our circumcision is done by Messiah, you know.
Yeah.
We don't come to a knowledge of it later on. But anyway, all these little details, and people get into arguments about it, and love just flies out the window. But here's the thing.
Oh, no.
the dog's helping. She's... all around.
Yeah.
But here's the thing. The love just flies out the window. And you have to look at the way that things were done in the as examples for us. The prophet Husha, they call him Hosea, was told to go marry a prostitute.
Hmm.
You know, that's not right for a priest to marry a prostitute. Hmm. But it was done for his specific job was to do that. And others have specific things that they have to do. And if we start looking, body parts start looking at each other and going, what's going on? You know, then they're off the job that they're given, and then now they're a judge. You know, yeah, they're policemen. Hmm. And that's not, we're connected to the head. If the head says something to do something, then that's what we do. If somebody goes out there and they use pagan names and they just fly out of their mouth, and they just use them all the time. And we know in our heart, if our heart has the lamp, the lamp has the oil of the word training in us, that we are not to pronounce the names of pagan deities. And we see someone else doing it. We're not supposed to go over and judge them. We're just supposed to remind them of the instruction and then forget about it. You know, just this is the word. It corrects. We don't correct. You see, the word corrects. So we just simply do it that way. If we're called to do that, I mean, you know, we may not have an opportunity to, but, you know, a lot of people would be, chopping, hands off and putting eyes out. you know, if they interpreted Yahusha's words literally the way that they claim that they should, you know. He's talking about how important it is that we put him in control, you know, rather than let our flesh run things, because the flesh is going to drive us into the lake of fire, you know. But, because that's where evil is. It's not in a in an object. You can't go, well, I'm going to go on and hunt for evil today, and I'm going to go into store after store and house after house and hunt down the evil. At one time, people who possessed the scriptures were considered to be in violation of the circus laws, and they would just eliminate them, you know, whole families.
Amazing. Chris was talking to me yesterday on the phone. He said, do you realize that every time you're talking to somebody, you're in spiritual warfare? I said, oh, I hadn't even thought of that, mate. I said, I tend to look at the people a bit too much. He said, there's just spirits flying around that person trying to stop whatever you say from going into them, and then things that they will say to put in them to make you wrong and to balk you and to try and upset you, to try and shut you up so that you're useless. And I guess because we're hairdressing and, you know, lots of people in a day, as yourself, you get lots of people, you sort of get to practice a little bit. And
a lot of tourists.
Yeah. So I hadn't really... It's been saying that for years, but I guess until you have a bit of experience, you don't really face it like that. You just get a bit upset at people. It's not people. It's principalities.
Quite true. I'm going to just turn this volume down just a little. That's better. Yeah. Okay. That sounds
better.
Yeah, that's much better. Yeah.
We watched your your seminar yesterday. That was amazing, brother. The Paracleta.
Yes, the Paracleta is present.
Yeah.
And that's the helper, you know, the spirit of Yahusha in us, and we are possessed. And we're possessed property, you know, because he's usurped us and taken over. But, you know, what oil is in our lamp? You know, see, our lamp is, there's lamp, we have to define the terms. The lamp is our spiritual vessel. And, of course, the eye is the lamp. And it's an entry point for the spirit of our living person inside of us. We're made up of spirit and flesh. So we have a physical component and a non-physical component. And that's created, you know, that way. And the oil is also a code word for the light, which is another thing I'm working on for the next seminar. It's, what is the light? What is it? It's a physical thing. It's something we can see, but then there's a metaphorical level, a figurative level. And the oil is also something that Scripture uses as a metaphor or a parallel word that means light, you know. That's why Psalm 119, verse 105, says, your word is a lamp to my feet and a light to my path. Now, the oil that's in the lamp is, it's interesting because a lamp, a physical lamp, it has a physical property to it. But then there's something that goes into the lamp called the oil. A lot of people understand that to be the spirit. Mm. It's the spirit Messiah. And what does the spirit bring with him? Well, he brings his character. And that is embodied in his word, the things that he's instructed us with. So it also would include his instructions. Mm. So when we have the instructions, then the five wise virgins have the oil. They have the instructions as well as the presence of the Spirit, but they don't have old traditions of men, and otherwise their lamps would just flicker out. Because the difference is in the wise virgins and the unwise virgins, typically what needs to be understood is that there's words that will never pass away. Oil that will never, ever be able to leave or burn up. It has an eternal quality to it. And so their vessels have stored away that which will never pass away. And that's Yahuwah's word. Mm-hmm. Now, traditions, on the other hand, traditions of men that seem religious and spiritual, but are not. They're just outward show, or they look appealing, and they seem good. They, you know, there's a way that seems right, but its end is death. Well, you see, that's the whole thing. So those things disappear, dry up, rot, and they blow away like chaff, because they go to their vessel and they go, what's this? Well, all they've ever put into their vessel, which is their heart, is men's traditions, and they just get burned up. They just fly. They mean nothing, you know, because they're not eternal. You know, the rules of the, you know, the Pharisees and the scribes had loads of rules, you know, lots of ideas, and they were just, you know, days that they were going to fast during the week. They just picked days, and they'd say, well, you know, and or if some rule that they made about whatever inheritance a person had that they might be able to take care of their parents with later, a lot of times people would inherit things, or they would become wealthy and they'd be able to take care of their parents. But then they made this rule that if whatever was for their parents is now dedicated to the temple, then that is not Yahuwah's will, you know. So these are all things that will pass away, that have no meaning. They're not eternal words, you know. And that's the old wine, you know. It's in the old wineskins. Yeah. And so we have to become new wineskins or new lamps. And our spirit will contain the oil that is everlasting, you know, the light that will never go out, you know. Yeah. Our lamps will never flicker out as long as we store that which is eternal, you know, eternal words.
There's actually an ancient oil lamp sitting next to us, brother. If anybody doesn't know what, it's not like the modern lamps, is it?
No, it's not. I have one. A brother and sister sent me one. Let me get it. It's right here.
Yeah.
If you hear a crash, it's all right. Okay. Now I had to get in this little thing here. Now look at this. Yeah. Okay, they were about this size.
That's small, isn't it?
Yeah, it's made of clay. There's the bottom. There's the top. And, you know, it's clay. It's formed. It has a wick. It has a wick inside. Let me see if I can get that out. That's burned. Let's see. I'll have to reach in there with a little tool here, but the oil was inserted through this hole in the top, and the wick would lay into the oil, and it would just sort of stick out, and it would absorb the oil, and the oil would come up and in the fibers, and the oil would burn. Mm. In fact, that's what actually has been used when we have Sabbath, quite often. Wow. See, the wick just sticks up like that.
Mm.
Anyway, they sent that to me. And
I thought they were like five times that size. That's really small, isn't it? Wow.
Yeah. Well, you have to consider that the flame is going to shoot up about this high.
Yeah, of course. Yeah.
And.
Mm.
Yeah. That's fascinating. And that's all it needs to be. I mean, the flame is, it doesn't matter how big the lamp is. Mm. All that does is it gives it a capacity for oil.
Mm.
And they would use olive oil. You know, you can burn olive oil in these. You know, it's an amazing thing. But this is what he was referring to as a lamp, and it's a vessel. And this is representative of our hearts. And the oil that goes in it that produces light, you know, like in the menorah, you know, it is a light to the world.
Yeah.
In 2 Corinthians 4, it says, "For Elohim who said, 'Let light shine out of darkness,' is the one who has shone in our hearts for the enlightening of the knowledge of the esteem of Elohim in the face of Yahusha Messiah. And we have this treasure in earthen vessels. He's not talking about these earthen vessels. He's talking about us. So that the excellence of the power which the oil provides might be of Elohim and not of us. So the power is his spirit in our lamps. That's energy, you know. And it's treasure too, because what else is not going to pass away? Gold and silver isn't going to help you. Treasure, true treasure, is eternal treasure. And that's his life that he brings to us, you know. And we absorb his character and his viewpoint. So we agree with it. See, that's the difference between a light eye and a dark eye. When somebody calls something an evil eye, that means a dark eye. That means an eye that's looking for an excuse to not obey. You know, like, for example, I'm not blaming anybody that feels this way, but if they say, I don't need to circumcise my male children on the eighth day. Or if somebody says, I don't need to keep Sabbath. Or I don't have to keep that commandment, but I want to keep these other ones. You know, see, that's a little here and a little there. But you have to say, well, what? It's all good. You know, there's nothing evil about any of them. But an evil eye or a dark eye will have a way of seeing things and get around them. You know, and say, well, I don't have to obey that because I'm not of that lineage, or some nonsense like that. Anyway, the choices that we make are based on that. You know, dark eye is going to look for excuses, and the eye of light is going to weigh everything according to whether or not it's good, and scripture backs it up. But of course, if we start whipping each other and saying, you're not doing it right, you know, all we have to do is share the word, you know. A lot of these people say, well, I don't believe that way. Well, they don't use scripture to train and correct. You notice that a lot. I was accused by a brother, a very angry man. I pray for him every day. He said, you're a liar and a Torah breaker and something else. And I said, it breaks my heart when I read these things, but I'm thinking, well, he's going to follow this up with where I lied or where I broke Torah. So, he didn't. So I wrote back and I said, please tell me, where was it, when was it, and what is the lie, and what Torah am I breaking? And no answer. You know? So if we're going to correct, we need and train and teach and rebuke, we want to always use the word, you know. Always do that. Because otherwise, we're just out there, you know, floundering.
I found it interesting in that seminar how, I mean, you're always saying, look, we shouldn't be arguing over fine details, and we shouldn't be arguing about his name and how to spell it and everything. And yet, all through it, I forget what the second word was. There was this word that was the mark of authenticity, his name.
Shibboleth.
Yeah, the shibboleth. And even though we shouldn't be arguing, it was a main point of what you were saying, that there is a correct way. Yeah.
There is a correct way, but we shouldn't be arguing about what we think is the correct way so much to judge others.
Yeah.
That's important.
that's going nuts today.
Is it?
Yeah.
Is it still out of focus?
It's okay now. Have you got the same setup as usual?
Yes.
Yeah.
I did. Well, anyway, and one other place where Yahusha is our best source for all these code words. Because he was very careful to explain these words to his disciples. But, you know, some of them he never really explained to. We have to have his spirit to know what they mean. But in Luke 12, around 30, verse 34, he said, for where your treasure is, there your heart shall be also. Let your loins be girded and your lamps burning, and be like men waiting for their master, when he shall return from the wedding, that when he comes and knocks, they open to him immediately. Now, if you know, we've heard the phrase, their hearts are burning, or your heart is burning. It means that your heart is really excited about something. Our hearts burn at times when we're in prayer, and it's because of his spirit, because he's burning into us some of these, well, the love sometimes, you know, it's all about love. Mm. Our hearts burn with love. That's what they do. It's because our hearts are the lamps. And they're called lamps, and we must fill them with an everlasting light called Torah, because it's the everlasting covenant. And that light is what, well, Psalm 119:105 reveals is the Torah. The Torah is a lamp and a light. Now, it says, Yahusha also said, my words shall by no means pass away. Well, that means they're everlasting. They're forever. And if we load those into our lamp is filled with his word. Not just the words that he said in the body, but the word that he was referring to. You know, the everlasting words of the covenant, you know. So, many traditions are just going to flip around. And he said in Matthew 24, which is an interesting place to put it, because it's the prophecy of the last days. The heavens and the earth shall pass away, but my words shall by no means pass away. And he wanted us to remember that during the distress, because he said it in Matthew 24. See, we're going to be going through the distress. If it's not us, it'll be our children or some generation. But that generation needs to know.
A friend of Amy's on, she hasn't really known her, but she communicated with her a couple of times on Facebook. They just had their 7-month-old little boy die. And she was really shaken up by it last night, to the point where she was, because they are very natural people, they didn't inoculate, and they didn't, you know, they had home births and they did all the things that like we do. And so she was kind of shaken, and then she started saying, oh, what happens if this happens to our kids, and what happens if that happens to our kids? And I said, well, were these people Nazarene? Were they in love with Yahusha? And she said, no. I said, well, that's the main point, you know. I said, he promises to protect us. I'm not saying I can foretell the future, but I'm just saying he promises to protect us if we're in a covenant. And we're going to have to get strong about these things, because people are just going to start falling all around us as time goes on. And it's going to be just heartbreaking.
Yes.
And our concern shouldn't be whether our bodies and our children are safe. Our concern, I mean, we're always wanting Yahusha to prove himself more and more. Why can't you just send something to wake them up? Well, he's going to do a lot of that through plagues and diseases and things like that. And when it comes, it's going to be devastating. And we have to get strong. So I said to her, I understand it's horrible and you can mourn. It's, you know, of course we mourn, but it's, you shouldn't be worried about your own family, because we're in a covenant and he'll look after us. And, you know, it's just going to get worse and worse and worse, isn't it?
What happened to the little child? 7 months.
I think it was some kind of flu or some kind of meningococcal, or we're not sure what it was. One day he was fine, the next day he was gone. That was what really shook her. So.
Yeah, we're surrounded with all sorts of things that can kill us all the time. Microbes, dangerous vehicles, all kinds of things. And just living in the universe in these bodies, I mean, anything can happen. But anyway, the thing that we have to get into our vessels is his Torah. And that covenant is constantly referred to. In Hebrews 8, I think it's around verse 8, it starts out saying, finding fault with him, he says, see, the days are coming, says Yahuwah, when I shall conclude with the house of Israel and with the house of Yehuda a renewed covenant, not according to the covenant that I made with their fathers in the day when I took them by the hand to lead them out of the land of Israel, because they did not continue in my covenant. And I disregarded them, says Yahuwah. But because this is the covenant that I shall make with the house of Israel after those days, says Yahuwah, giving my laws in their mind, and I shall write them on their hearts, and I shall be their Elohim, and they shall be my people. Now, when we understand the code words, hearts, he's talking about not writing the covenant in stone, but he's going to write it in our spirits. He's going to make our spirits join with his spirit. and we're going to be enabled to obey. That's a whole lot different than the way it was for them. Mm. And that's what we're seeing now. And that's why we have such a contention with the Christian teachings, because they're saying no one can obey. They don't have a verse to go to explain that. But the lamp is our heart, which is our spirit. And the oil is the mind of the spirit, which consists, at least includes, Yahuwah's Torah. And that results in our vessels becoming like examples of the light. Our behavior, the fruit, is exemplified. It's manifested to the outside world by our behavior, you know. But anyway, the thing of it is, on the other hand, we have, well, Paul wrote about it in 2 Timothy verse 4. He said, proclaim the word. The word, that's the covenant. Be urgent in season and out of season, meaning during the festivals and even when festivals are not happening. Reprove, warn, appeal with all patience and teaching. For there shall be a time when they shall not bear sound teaching, but according to their own desires, they heap up for themselves teachers, tickling the ear. And they shall indeed turn their eyes away from the truth and be turned aside to myths. But you be sober in all matters and suffer hardships. Do the work of an evangelist and accomplish your service completely. So that would mean that we'd have to address things that we see in the world and say, well, has society really turned aside to myths? We know they have. Yeah. But we don't do them, and we don't criticize them. We just show them the truth, and then they will automatically turn away from that when they accept it. Mm. When they accept the truth. You can't go up to a person that's dead or that has a wineskin loaded down with old wine or a lamp that's filled with no oil but men's teachings, and say to them, you know what you really need to be doing is not doing what you're doing. You know, they're going to look at you and say, what? You know, but if you tell them the truth, then eventually that will change them, you know, because his spirit will respond, because it says that those who obey him receive his spirit. That's Acts 5:32. So the lamp is our heart, which is our spiritual component. And the oil represents teachings, which are eternal, the eternal words. Mm. And that corresponds, in another sense, to wineskins being our heart. It's the same thing as a lamp. And that's our inner spirit. And the new wine is, of course, the Torah, his teachings, the eternal words. And the old wine would represent men's traditions or men's teachings, you know. And the metaphors are actually used in order to conceal the meaning from people who are rebellious. So those who want to keep the men's traditions will resist the truth, and they will have a form of Elohimness, but they will deny the power. They will not accept the spirit of Yahusha that's knocking. And the metaphors are parables. All the parables were spoken to conceal the truth. Mm. You know, that's why it's, let he who has ears to hear, let him hear. But the taught ones came and said, why do you speak to them in parables? And he said, answering them, he said, because it has been given to you to know the secrets of the reign of the heavens, but to them it has not been given. For whoever possesses, to him more shall be given, and he will have overflowingly. But whoever does not possess, even what he possesses shall be taken from him. So he speaks to them in parables for that reason, so that they might not understand because of their heart. Their heart is filled with things that they don't know are errors, because no one's telling them. But we're here to tell them that if you put up a Christmas tree and you don't know what you're doing, you better analyze it and find out what it is. And that's where it started for me. It sent me into an investigation. And then I found out, you know, over time, what it is. Hmm. And it says in Psalm 119 also, verse 29, remove from me the way of falsehood and favor me with your Torah. Well, that's saying it right there. It's a plea for him to help, and he will. If you ask him to remove the errors and the falsehoods and restore to him his Torah instructions, that's what Torah means. Yahuwah's instructions. Who's going to go to a father and ask for a piece of bread, and he's going to give him something like a snake or a stone? If you plead with your father, the creator, Yahuwah, please teach me your instructions, he's going to do it, you know. But you've got to humble yourself to even ask that, asking for that. Yeah. Anyway, the five virgins that are wise and the five virgins that are unwise, there's a distinction between them, and it seems to involve their oil. They all have lamps, but they don't have any oil for those lamps. And we are defining that oil as the spirit that brings with him his teachings and his covenant, you know. And you can read that in Matthew 25, verses 1 through 12. Then the rain of the heavens shall be compared to 10 maidens who took their lamps and went out to meet the bridegroom. Five of them were wise and five foolish. Those who were foolish, having taken their lamps, took no oil with them. But the wise took oil in their containers with their lamps. And then it says, now while the bridegroom took time, they all slumbered and slept. And at midnight a cry was heard, see, the bridegroom is coming. Go out to meet him. Then all those maidens rose up and trimmed their lamps. And the foolish said to the wise, give us of your oil, because our lamps are going out. Those men's traditions just weren't holding up. But the wise answered, saying, no, indeed, there would not be enough for us and you. Instead, go to those who sell and buy for yourselves. While they went to buy, the bridegroom came, and those who were ready went in with him to the wedding feast, and the door was shut. And later the other maidens came also and said, Master, Master, open up for us. But he answered and said, truly I say to you, I do not know you. You know, they don't know his name, they don't know what their groom wants them to do. And he says, I never knew you. And that's what he says in another place in Matthew 7, where he's at verse 23, he says, and then I shall declare to them who have done all these wondrous things in their heads, I never knew you. Depart from me, you who work lawlessness. Mm-hmm. See, they don't really know. They're being told that legalism is bad. Mm-hmm. Legalism is being legal, and that's a good thing.
So do you think the wise and foolish virgins are all immersed believers, or do you think it goes wider than that? Do you think they're all they've all immersed believers, and some are filled with oil and some are not? Or do you think it extends out to other, like he says, I never knew you. And he couldn't say that to an immersed believer, could he? Because he once would have known them. Or I that's a bit confusing to me.
Well, the answer to your question is best answered by Yahusha's words in a place where he said that the identity of his followers would be those who have love for one another. Mm-hmm. And if we're going to use an identification process, it would not be whether or not they're immersed or not, you know, because a lot of people focus on what we're doing. But we have to look at the behavior. And we make a critical judgment like that, not salvational, but we can determine who is and who is not a follower of him by whether or not they have love for one another. And if they're angry at always and they're judgmental, and those are, he didn't say that you'll know that they're my disciples by the fact that they have arguments on the internet and they're disputing all the time and they have a critical attitude. And they are always enforcing my laws. That's not what he said. Because he's the judge. But he said that the ones that love one another are his disciples. It's evidence. You know, it isn't evidence that they speak in tongues or that they're immersed. Because, see, these are all things that are easily, shall we say, camouflaged or an imposter can teach people error and mimic Yahuwah. In fact, the identity thief would like nothing more than to do everything like Yahusha does, but then lack the power, his spirit, to enable his followers to obey. So a person can go through the outward motions and seem to be in the light, but when you walk up to them and you say, well, you keep saying the Lord is your shepherd. Do you know who the Lord is? Do you know his name? And do you know what the word Lord means in Hebrew? Well, you're saying that B-A-A-L is your shepherd. You have to never supplant his name. You need to correct that. And then if they get all mad at you and they say, what? You know, all you're doing is showing them the truth. You're not judging them. But they will sometimes lash out at you, you know.
That's amazing. Just going through the motions, that would be the characteristics of a Darnell, wouldn't it? That have been sown in among us, that look like us, that have gone through all the same steps, but like you said, there's no love.
There's no love. In fact, a lot of times weeds will look beautiful, and they will even sometimes look very much like another plant. Yeah. But fellowshipping with him in our spirits, we will have that light, which is the oil, because light and oil mean basically the same thing. It's when you're talking about a lamp in a metaphorical way, the light that's in the lamp is not the wick, it's the oil that's burning. And that's what we have to understand is the oil of the Spirit. The Spirit is the oil, and the Messiah Spirit in us is going to reach through our vessels into other people's lives. And it's going to light, it's going to give them light. And we have to start with his name to make sure we're identifying who it is that we serve so that there's no misunderstandings. And then his word, what he says, not what we say or not what we desire, but what he says. And just obey that. And our actions and our behavior will reflect his light. You know, and it'll light the entire environment that we're engaged in enlightening. That's why it's an interesting thing that enlightenment is a word that we have in the English language that is a metaphorical thing, really, you know, because it doesn't really refer to light. It refers to wisdom. And, you know, wisdom is... There's one text that I think is really interesting. It's, wait just a minute. Let me see if I can find it. Let's see. We're going to be looking at this and this. Let's see. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. There's a place where... Am I in focus?
Yes.
Yahusha is talking, and he's talking to these people about this. He says, the son of Adam came eating and drinking, and they say, see a man, a glutton, and a wine drinker, and a friend of tax collectors and sinners. A friend of sinners.
Yeah. And, disgusting.
And then he says, and yet wisdom was declared right by her works. In other words, the results of that is going to be a good thing, you know.
That implies we should be doing some works, doesn't it?
Well, we're supposed to teach the lost, and if we just hunt down people that already know and we say, look, we found them. No, you're not supposed to be hunting down each other. You're supposed to be hunting down the lost. That is when you're fully equipped. Now, if you're having trouble understanding, reading the scriptures, and then you go to a teacher that understands what the scriptures are, and you ask them a few questions, you shouldn't spend the next 10 years asking that same teacher for things. But there's different teachers that have different gifts. Some teachers are skilled because they've been given the toolbox that they've been given to break down certain kinds of strongholds. And other teachers break down different strongholds. But we're all doing the stronghold battle. because the false reasonings are mostly what we're overcoming. But different teachers have different equipment. But then once you've done that, then, you know, that's that work is done. But then there's masses and masses of people. There are billions of people on this planet that need to know. And their lives are just ticking by. Their wick is burning, you know. Their life is shortening. Every day that you live, you get closer to the day that you're going to die, and then you won't be in the flesh anymore. And you've got to give an accounting for what you did while in the flesh. And if you never hear, and you just choose to ignore the truth, which is his covenant, then we've got to assume that there's going to be some serious problems for that person ahead, eternal problems. But anyway, that wisdom is including the idea of, you know, being the Torah, you know, because the Torah cries out at the head of the streets and at the gates, it says in Proverbs. Well, what would that be? Well, that would be because they're written there. The covenant was, we were instructed to write his covenant on our gates, at the entrances of the cities, and on all our doorposts. Well, if wisdom is the Torah, the Ten Words, the covenant, then they will be known. You know, and the children and the citizens will all be aware of what those right rulings really are. So the behavior of the citizen or a member of the household that's taught the covenant would be different, you know, than the behavior of another. So we understand that the critical questions is what is the light and what is fellowship with him, and it is union with him by receiving his spirit and understanding that his instructions are going to live with us eternally. A billion years from now, the Ten Commandments will still be in place. You know, we won't be able to misuse or destroy his name. His name will be his name. It won't be a different name. He says there will be different names. That is a modification of his name, but the core of his name is the same. You know, like the name of the new Jerusalem is going to be Yahuwah Shema. That means Yahuwah is there. You know, he still has the same name, and the new Jerusalem is never going to pass away. So. And it's interesting, we start at the name, though, because in the prophet Isaiah, or Yeshayahu, in chapter 56, it says, also the sons of the foreigner who join themselves to Yahuwah to serve him and to love the name of Yahuwah, to be his servants, all who guard the Sabbath and not profane it and hold fast to my covenant, them I shall bring to my set-apart mountain and let them rejoice in my house of prayer. So that's amazing, yeah.
They get told to stay away from that Old Testament, don't they? Because it's got it everywhere. Loving his name, loving his covenant, the Sabbath.
Yeah. Those are future things. You know, those are things to be in the future. Because there's lots of things. I mean, like Yeshayahu or Isaiah chapter 66 talks about in the last days, during when he gathers all the nations together. He's referring to Yehoshaphat, the Armageddon is what he's referring to. He's going to destroy many, and those that are eat abominable things that set themselves apart to go into the farms or the gardens and eat the flesh of pigs. You know, there was a girl that was passing me in the grocery yesterday. I had to go shopping with my wife, and she was trying to entice us to take a sample of a ham sandwich. And I said, that's not food, but thank you anyway.
Yeah.
Oh boy.
Might as well offer me the leg of a chair.
Yeah, if our behavior and our practicing our life is not walking in the truth, then we're walking in darkness. And, you know, in Yahuchana or John chapter 8, verse 12, it says, therefore, Yahusha spoke to them again, saying, I am the light of the world. He who follows me shall by no means walk in darkness, but possess the light of life. Now, if you're following him, you're walking the way he walked. You know, walking means behavior. It means how you practice, you know. Then in 1 Yohanan 2, starting in verse 4, it says, the one who says, I know him, and does not guard his commands, is a liar, and the truth is not in him. But whoever guards his word, truly the love of Elohim has been perfected in him. By this we know that we are in him. The one who says he stays in him ought himself also to walk, even as he walked. So it teaches us love, you know. So if we miss that goal, it doesn't matter, you know.
Reminded me when Chris was telling me about the spiritual warfare. He said, if you're talking and you're loving somebody and they don't let you have it, or they don't accept you, or they don't receive anything you've said, are they in the truth or are they in a lie? And I said, oh, they're in a lie. He said, so what are they? I said, they're a liar. He said, do you face that? You know, if they won't come into the truth and they're not filled with his love, they can just tell lies and manipulate and do these things. And if you don't have your eyes open, you can just get stabbed and wounded and hurt and shut up and everything like that. I just reminded me, because I said it's a lie. We're surrounded by lies all the time. And I know we're not supposed to be out there attacking people and on the defense, but if we don't have our armor on and face what we're dealing with, we just get rendered useless, don't we?
We can take it personally, and that's the wrong thing. Because, see, what we're really dealing with is not the person. We're dealing with the strongholds and the false reasonings, which are the source of the lies. And those that's the old wine that's talking. And they're saying, and they're pleading, and they're wrestling, saying, no, this old wine that I have stored in my vessel, it's right. And they're denying that it's false. But that's because they don't know it is. But when we teach them the truth, when they hear the real thing, then that will break them of their stony heart. Because the word is like a hammer. And it will, when it goes forth, it will produce that which it was sent to do. You know, the word is the only true power.
Mm. So, we don't realize that, do we? His word has amazing power. We don't have to jump up and down. Don't have to jump up and down and fight with it or anything. It just stands. You can't shake it.
That's right.
You don't have to defend it.
It doesn't. The truth doesn't need to be defended. And all we have to do is just, he'll store if we're storing his oil in us, his mind is there, he will give us the words to say. And then we're going to say them in kindness and gentleness, in love. You know, now he can yell, but we should not yell. Unless he yells through us. But if we're enraged, if our hearts are enraged, it's not us, it's our flesh that's speaking. And our flesh can get riled up because we're emotional creatures. And what we need to do is get out of the way and let him lovingly reach out to them. Because it's through love that draws his beloved. If he's drawing a person, he's not going to draw them, you know, with malice and hatred. He's going to lovingly woo those that he's calling. He's calling. He's not, you know, shouting. He's calling. Come back. This is true. This is good. And a person that is brash or hateful is not, you know, he's getting in the way. But we need to not judge them, but we need to use the word, you know. But if their hearts are hard, they can still be shattered. Because all it has to take is his spirit. You know. But a lot of people are just worried about whether or not they're going to be, if they have to change. It's hard enough for them to change. In fact, that's a miracle that they can even change. But the fact is, the pressures of the world can can choke out the truth, even though they know that it is true. And because family or old relationships, pastors and things like that. So the pressure is there, but, you know, through his spirit, that power that's in our lamp, he's the spirit. It's not by power of our strength of ourselves or by might. It's by his spirit that we overcome. And that's very important that we let him take over. But if we, anyway, in 1 Yohanan chapter 1, verse 6, it says, if we say that we have fellowship with him and we walk in darkness, we lie and we're not doing the truth. Now, that means we're not practicing the truth. But if we walk in the light, that means practice the truth. As he is in the light, we have fellowship with one another. And the blood of Yahusha Messiah, his son, cleanses us from all sin. So we have to practice it. See, that's what doing the word is.
That's amazing. Just realizing all this stuff. Just amazing how powerful it is.
Yeah, and to know him, to know that we know him by the fact that we are agreeing with his spirit and obeying, you know. When we obey, we receive more and more and more of his spirit. Because it says in Acts 5:32, as I mentioned before, that the spirit is given to those who obey him. And the one that obeys, continues to obey, and continues to obey, and repent and obey, receives greater and greater and greater measures of the spirit. Not that that would be the reason that you would want to pursue it only, but in order to help others, because the others that are perishing are out there in the billions, you know, and they're not even aware because they're being taught very strange doctrines, you know, that they don't have to obey the covenant. He knows what his name is. I don't need to know. there's all kinds of things. But, you know, one of the most incredible people that gets overlooked in the scriptures that was a follower is, and I mentioned this in this past, in this seminar, the lamp, is the man that we call Stephen in Acts chapter 7. And Stephen is just amazing. I'm going to try to bring him up in the next one too. We're going to be dealing with the light. But the living words, he spoke to the Sanhedrin and he spoke of the Ten Commandments and called them the living words, you know. And if we don't know what they are, you know, that's strange. How could we claim that we have his spirit and yet not meditate upon his word? You know, Stephen was talking to the Sanhedrin in Acts 7, I think it was around verse 38. He said, this is the one, this is he who was in the assembly in the wilderness with the messenger. Now, he's speaking of Moses or Moshe. And he's talking about a messenger. Well, the messenger, you know what the messenger looked like? Messenger looked like a pillar of fire. His name was in him. And he says, this is he who was in the assembly in the wilderness with the messenger, who spoke to him on Mount Sinai. The messenger was speaking to him on Mount Sinai. And with our fathers, who received the living words to give to us, unto whom our fathers would not become obedient, but thrust away. And in their hearts, they turned back to Mitzrayim. It's interesting that Stephen, those are his words in translation, that Luke wrote down. But Stephen is talking about these living words. He's talking about this messenger that gave the words at Mount Sinai. And he talks about thrust them away. The fathers thrust these words away, and in their hearts, they turn back to Mitzrayim, in their hearts. So there's the word heart right there. That's our lamp. He said to Aharon, make us mighty ones to go before us, for this Moshe, who led us out of the land of Mitzrayim, we do not know what has become of him. And they made a calf in those days and brought an offering to the idol and were rejoicing in the works of their own hands. In other words, you can make up religious duties to do, spiritual duties, whatever you want to call them, and call them sacraments. like they exist or something. You know, if anybody can find a sacrament that's actually described as a sacrament, then we need to know about it, because there's nothing in the scriptures about this. But they made up these sacraments, and many, many Christians understand the word sacraments. And altar, and they're talking about an indoor altar. You know, they go to an altar to get married. What is that about? You know. Anyway, Psalm 119, again, at verse 104 and 105 says, "From your orders I get understanding. Therefore I have hated every false way. Your word is a lamp to my feet and a light to my path." So what I just talked about, sacraments and indoor altars, and, you know, see, those are not words that he's given us. His words are everlasting words. And then a really interesting thing happens when Yahusha said in Matthew 5, "You are the light of the world. It is impossible for a city to be hidden on a mountain, nor do they light a lamp and put it under a basket, but on a lampstand, and it shines to all those in the house. Let your light so shine before men so that they see your good works and praise your Father who is in the heavens. Do not think that I came to destroy the Torah or the prophets. I did not come to destroy, but to fulfill or complete. For truly, I say to you, till the heavens and the earth pass away, one yod or one tittle shall by no means pass from the Torah till all be done." That's, and the heavens are still there. The earth's still here. But we just tend to make things up, and, you know, like the strange fire that Aharon's two sons brought before Yahuwah. They took a fire holder and put fire in it, and then they brought strange fire before Yahuwah that was not commanded. And the fire from Yahuwah came out and consumed them. I think that was in Leviticus 10. Yeah. But the evil eye is looking at things and justifying them and saying, "Oh, I think it's going to be all right. We can compromise here and he'll understand." Yeah. Or things be the way they were because they didn't have refrigeration back then. You know, they didn't have refrigeration. You know, he said, "This is an abomination." You know, and you're saying it's not, it's okay now because we have refrigeration. You know, I've heard that. Have you ever heard that?
No. What's that dealing with? Pigs?
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah.
Well, pigs mostly, yeah. But anyway, yeah, I've heard it. It's that's the evil eye. That's the dark eye. That's the way you look at something and say, well, you're not looking at it from his point of view. You're looking at it from your point of view. Mm. And that's the mind of the flesh instead of the mind of the spirit, you know. Mm. So
his blood can cover all that. There's no problem. He loves us. Let his blood cover that.
Except for the fact that you're not repenting. That's the main issue there. Mm. But anyway, it's in 1 Yehuchadnezzar 1, it says, "And this is the message which we have heard from him, and we announce to you, that Elohim is light, and in him is no darkness at all. If we say we have fellowship with him and walk in darkness, we lie and are not doing the truth. But if we walk in the light," and that's doing Torah, "as he is in the light, we have fellowship with one another. And the blood of Yahusha Messiah, his son, cleanses us from all sin." You just talked about that. His blood covers us even if we don't repent. Mm-hmm. No, that's not what it says. It does not say that. It does not say that we have, that he is willing to just say, "Oh, it doesn't matter anymore." It's more like what you feel than anything else, or that my blood will cover you, your sins, and you don't need to repent. He doesn't say that. It doesn't say that we have, what do they call it in the Christian circles? They say
grace,
but they also, that's a Hebrew word, hasid, that means unmerited loving kindness. Mm. But if you know to do something and then you do not do it, it is sin. Mm. You know, But if you hear the truth and then you turn away from it, then your prayers are an abomination. If you read Proverbs 28, verse 9, it says, he who hears the Torah or turns his ear away from hearing the Torah, then even his prayer is an abomination. Maybe I may have to read that verbatim, but that's basically what it's saying. And it just before the last days, it says in a message of Eliyahu in Malachi, it says, remember the Torah of Moshe, my servant, which I commanded him in Horeb for all Israel, laws and right rulings. See, I am sending you Eliyahu the prophet before the coming of the great and awesome day of Yahuwah. And he shall turn the hearts of the fathers to the children, and the hearts of the children to their fathers, lest I come and smite the earth with utter destruction. So we have to go back to Deuteronomy chapter 5 and look again at the retelling of the covenant. You know, and he tells us the 10 words, and then the Great Commission. A lot of times people read the Great Commission at Matthew 28, verses 18 through 20, and they don't hear what he's really saying. It says, and Yahusha came up. This is the resurrected Yahusha. He's about to leave, and it says, and Yahusha came up and spoke to them, saying, all authority has been given to me in heaven and on earth. Therefore, go and make taught ones of all the nations, immersing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the set apart Spirit, teaching them to guard all that I have commanded you. And see, I am with you always until the end of the age. So that's the power of the Spirit, because he's with us. Teach them the name and the covenant, and prepare them for the day of Yahuwah. But instead of calling it the Great Commission, it's almost thought of as the Great Omission. You know, what in the world? They omit his name. They say, well, we're going to call him the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, and we're going to refer to him that way always, even though it's a singular thing. It's not three. It says the name. It doesn't say the names. Anyway, and then the second part, see, they omitted his name. So it's the Great Omission. And it starts out with his name. And the second half of that is his word, teaching them to guard all that I commanded you, which is his word. Now, there's his name and his word. That's what Nazarim are always teaching. We go again. It's great. It's not hard. It's not like having to go to some giant scientific university that knows all things so that we can come out of it and go, okay, I get it. No, you need his Spirit. You need him. And then everything will become easy for you. So you can, yeah, get possessed. Anyway, the command is a lamp, and the Torah is a light, the reproofs of discipline, a way of life, to guard you against an evil woman from the flattering tongue of a strange woman. Now, the woman can be a metaphor as well as all the other things are metaphors. It can be a literal woman. That's true. Now, here's the thing, though. If you have his covenant in you, you're not going to go out and commit adultery and whore around with women, or vice versa, with men. But if you have his covenant in you, then you're not going to fall for a woman that's a false religion. Because the woman that's referred to in the scriptures all the way through, A-S-H-E-R-A-H, you know, the consort of B-A-A-L, the Israel was always tempted by these false religions, you know, and that's an evil woman. An evil woman would not be a wise woman, you know, because wisdom is considered to be a woman. You know, the Torah is a feminine word, a word. And kokma is a feminine word, you know. Kokma is the word for wisdom in Hebrew. But false religions would all be women, you know. And in fact, it's interesting that the mother circus, you know who I'm talking about, and sorry, Phyllis, I brought it up again. That has been the greatest deception throughout the longest period of time, which is what spawned Christianity.
Talking the Roman Catholic circus.
The Roman Catholic circus, the magisterium, with all of its popes, bishops, sacraments, and false Sabbath. And that false religion is a woman. It even refers to it as the mother. She says, you know, she claims that she's a mother, the mother circus. The people that don't know why we're calling it a circus, they're probably thinking we're being insulting, but that's what the word C-I-R-C-E means, you know, that they inherited as C-H-U-R-C-H. But
the pagan deity, sea girl.
Yeah. But it does say that in the last days, in Micah 4, in the last days it shall be that the mountain of the house of Yahuwah is established on the top of the mountains and shall be exalted above the hills. And the peoples shall flow to it. And many nations shall come and say, come, let us go up to the mountain of Yahuwah, to the house of the Elohim of Yaakov, and let him teach us his ways, and let us walk in his paths. For out of Sion comes forth the Torah and the word of Yahuwah from Jerusalem. What? It's not Rome? Oh, boy. And what is coming out of there? Torah, you know. Not some different Torah. But men's traditions are very, very deceptive. And in Psalm 119, 160, it says, the sum of your word is truth, and all your righteous rulings are forever. That's the end of it, yeah. And what does it say in Ecclesiastes? It says, and this is the sum of everything up. We're to do Yahuwah's Torah. And this is the duty of all men, you know. Mm-hmm. And it says also that his word is a treasure in Psalm 119, verse 162. I rejoice at your word as one who finds great treasure. Mm-hmm. And it talks about his word all the time. In Yehukinen, or John 17, verse 17, set them apart in your truth. Your word is truth. And then it says in a little later in another chapter, in Yehukinen or John chapter 18, verse 37, Pilate said to Yahusha, to him, you are a sovereign then? Yahusha answered, you say it, because I am a sovereign. For this I was born, and for this I have come into the world, that I should bear witness to the truth. Everyone who is of the truth hears my voice. That really grabbed me when I heard it, because Yahuwah has always been saying to obey his voice, you know. And when he talked about the messenger being in the pillar of fire, he said, do everything that he says to do. Obey him, for my name is in him. And I'm thinking, wow, there it is again, you know. It's just everywhere. And in Psalm 1, it starts down, the very first Psalm. Blessed is the man who shall not walk in the counsel of the wrong, and shall not stand in the path of sinners, and shall not sit in the seat of scoffers. But his delight is in the Torah of Yahuwah, and he meditates in his Torah day and night. You know? And it's saying he'll be like a tree planted by rivers and waters. He won't dry up. And its fruit will yield fruit in its season, and its leaf will not wither, and whatever he does prospers.
That's amazing. I mean, it's so wonderful to be able to hear his voice, but
yeah,
I have to look at this truthfully and say, yeah, I can hear his voice, but is his word a delight to me? Is it the most important thing in my life? Would I put anything off for his word? Because that's what the wise virgins had. They had oil. The foolish might love him desperately, but they didn't have enough oil in them, so that when times got tough or something happened, they'd run out of oil. So for me, I don't know about anybody else, but I just look at this and go, oh, I need to be more in love with his word, you know? It's great to be working for him and hear his voice and everything, but what about his word? Meditating in his Torah day and night. It's just, you know, I know we can't physically sit there all day and night, but I mean, is it even important to us? You know? That's just a blowout to me.
Isn't it? Oh, yeah, you said it. It's like, wow. There's the difference. The five unwise virgins are not doing those things. Mm. They're storing other things in their lamp that are not eternal, that burn up, that are not eternal, you know. But, you know, when you said that it's a matter of, am I meditating in his word, his Torah? And if we're not doing that, you know, sometimes, like I said before, I'll just find myself driving along and I'll just start reciting the Ten Commandments and in order, you know, just one after the other. Let listen to him and speak through them, because he's speaking to your heart. You're storing them in your vessel when you do that. And then when temptation comes, those words are burned into your heart and you go, oh no, it just goes completely against your nature because you're not able to, it doesn't have any effect on you. That's why it's called like a necklace of protection. It's something that's an adornment, that's a true treasure. And it is the power that's stored in your lamp. It is his spirit. Because, you know, if you do that, and do you think he notices it? Absolutely. It's not that you're out to get his attention, but you want to be in fellowship with him. And if you're not doing these things, then how can you be in fellowship with him? You know. But it says the Torah is a treasure, and it's the power of Yahuwah stored in earthen vessels. And I've read this before, but it gives us the empowerment. In 2 Corinthians chapter 4, and we have this treasure in earthen vessels, so that the excellence of the power might be of Elohim and not of us. Now, it's about the heart and the oil. And this is an example of a, you know, an earthen vessel. But it's talking about us. You know, we're the earthen vessel. But inside of us is stored this precious commodity, his spirit, which gives, it's like the oil. And it's the power. It's the power source. What's the power source of a lamp? The oil. And it comes up through the wick, and it burns brightly. And it's the oil that's giving the power. That's the spirit that gives us the power. And it is the treasure. It's the thing that is constantly being referred to in Scripture.
When we were in the circus, it was almost like his spirit and his word were two different things. It was always about prophecy and hearing his voice, and that was so important to be moving and acting in the spirit. I'm realizing now that to communicate with him, really, like you said, the power source is the oil. I mean, oil is spirit too, but it's word. It's his word. He's not going to tell us something new and original that's not in agreement to his Torah, to his word, is he? It's all written there.
Because that's his mind. His mind is joined to your mind, and that's the oil. That's the spirit that you've enjoined to the Creator's mind, and so that you're in full agreement with his heart. See, because his heart is much, much greater than our heart, and it's a power source. But it doesn't shine in some people. It's darkness. It comes out of them, you know. It's mentioned in Romans 8. In fact, Romans chapter 6, 7, and 8 actually exemplify from Paul how the new or renewed covenant actually works in our lives. And in chapter 8, starting at verse 5, it says, "For those who live according to the flesh set their minds on the matters of the flesh. But those who live according to the Spirit, the matters of the Spirit. For the mind of the flesh is death, but the mind of the Spirit is life and peace. Because the mind of the flesh is hatred towards Elohim, for it does not subject itself to the Torah of Elohim. neither indeed is it able. Those who are in the mind of the flesh are unable to please Elohim. But you are not in the flesh, but in the Spirit, if indeed the Spirit of Elohim dwells in you. See, if he dwells in you, then if anyone does not have the Spirit in their vessel, this one is not his. In other words, it says, if anyone does not have the Spirit of Messiah, this one is not his. You don't belong to him. That's a scary thing when you think about it.
Yeah.
And it talks about oils in the, like in the Song of Solomon, chapter 1, verse 3, the fragrance of your oils are good. Talking about perfumed oils, the smell. And then it says, your name is oil poured forth. Therefore, maidens love you. And the maidens remind us of the 10 maidens and their lamps. And in Ecclesiastes 7, it says, a good name is better than precious oil, and the day of death than the day of one's birth. But notice that the word oil is in there, and the name is also in there. You know. But the thing that won't pass away in our vessels is the treasure. Silver and gold can get stolen. Iron can rust. All the things in the world that we can store in our vessels that are men's traditions, they'll pass away. But his words will never pass away. And it's interesting that he said it in Matthew 24, in verse 35, the heavens and the earth shall pass away, but my words shall by no means pass away. We can actually, during the distress, we'll be understanding that we're not on, our foundation is sure, you know. And he's always talking about his name and his word, you know. But the identity thief is always trying to not use his name or to confuse us by adding letters and let's not say that name or let's, you know, all kinds of different excuses. Those are dark eyes. You know, we need to stay away from the dark eye. Now, there's something here that we should probably bring up in regard to the lamp. The idea that these words are going to come upon us in the latter days that we have to store in our lamps. And it says in Deuteronomy 4, starting in verse 27, and Yahuwah shall scatter you among the peoples. Hello, you're in Australia. I'm in North America. And you shall be left few in number among the Gentiles where Yahuwah drives you. That's for sure. I'm among the Gentiles. Boy, am I scarce. You know, I'm few in number because there's not many people around this city that want to hear. Now, and there you shall serve mighty ones, the work of men's hands, wood and stone, which neither see nor hear nor eat nor smell. But from there you shall seek Yahuwah your Elohim and shall find when you search for him with all your heart and with all your being. In your distress, when all these words shall come upon you in the latter days, then you shall return to Yahuwah your Elohim and shall obey his voice. He doesn't say you'll have to move anywhere. He just simply says that you shall return to Yahuwah and obey his voice. For Yahuwah your Elohim is a compassionate El. He does not forsake you nor destroy you, nor forget the covenant of your fathers, which he swore to them. That's great.
That's important to remember as things get tougher and we see all the devastation around us, isn't it? He does not forsake us or destroy us. He's compassionate.
And even during that's in Malachi 4 in the next part where it says, remember the Torah of Moshe my servant, which I commanded him for all Israel. And it says that he's going to send Eliyahu the prophet before the coming of the great and awesome day of Yahuwah, which is going to be a very eventful time. And it's very close. And it even talks about that in Hebrews 4 too. Hebrews 4, it says, for the word of Elohim is living and working and sharper than any two-edged sword, cutting through even to the dividing of being and spirit, of joints and marrow and able to judge the thoughts and intentions of the heart. Mm. Wow. See?
A person can't do that.
No, you need his spirit burning in your heart. Because, see, our hearts are lamps. And we need to be burning the oil that's in our lamps, that's eternal, while we're yet alive, so that people will see the light, you know. Luke 12:34 says, "For where your treasure is, your heart shall be. Let your loins be girded, your lamps burning." You know, in other words, let's go. You know, your lamps burning the light of the Torah. You know, you love it. You're thinking about it, meditating on it all the time. And, you know. He talks about the wise managers also, who were feeding the household, you know, in their, like, for example, it says, "Blessed are those servants whom the master, when he comes, shall find watching. Truly I say to you that he shall gird himself and make them sit down to eat." That's the wedding supper. "And shall come and serve them. And if he comes in the second watch or in the third watch and finds them so, blessed are those servants. And know this, that if the master of the house had known what hour the thief comes, he would have watched and not allowed his house to be broken into. But you then, and you then, be ready. For the Son of Adam is coming at an hour that you do not expect." So, what follows seems to imply that the ten virgins are the managers or the teachers of Yahusha's word that feeds the household at the appropriate time. And the wise managers are referred to in this explanation that Yahusha gives about the household. Kepha said to him, "Master, do you speak this parable to us or also to all?" And the master said, "Who then is the trustworthy and wise manager whom his master shall appoint over his household to give the portion of food in due season?" Now that food that he's talking about is the bread, which is his Torah. Feeding the household means teaching the other servants the Torah. "Blessed is that servant whom his master shall find so doing when he comes. Truly I say to you that he shall appoint him over all his possessions. But if that servant says in his heart, 'My master is delaying his coming,' and begins to beat the male servants and the female servants, and to eat and drink and be drunk, the master of that servant shall come on a day when he does not expect him, and in an hour that he does not know, and shall cut him in two and appoint his portion with the unbelievers. And that servant who knew his master's desire and did not prepare, nor did according to his desire, shall be beaten with many stripes." In other words, the managers, or the teachers, are held to a higher standard. In other words, that servant who knew his master's desire, but did not prepare, nor did according to his desire. In other words, teach the other people the truth. Like, you know what that steeple means. Why is it up on your building? I've talked to them before. They do know what it is, but they will not take it down. They won't know it's a circus if we take that steeple down. Some have taken it down, and they get in the news for having done so. But he did not know. But no, he who did not know, in other words, the person who's he's not responsible because he didn't know. But he who did not know, yet did what deserved flogging, shall be beaten with few. And everyone who much is given, from him much shall be demanded. And to whom much has been entrusted, from him much more shall be asked. So the more you know, the more responsible you are. But you want to be receive more so that you can be more effective. But anyway, we're talking about the wineskins. And, you know, the time that the Pharisees and the scribes were talking to Yahusha and criticizing him for not washing his hands and not doing the fasting the way that Yahuchanan's servants did, or disciples. In Luke 5, starting at verse 37, he explains it with wineskins. And no one puts new wine into old wineskins. Otherwise, the new wine shall burst the wineskins and run out, and the wineskins shall be ruined. But the new wine is put into fresh wineskins, and both are preserved. And no one, having drunk old wine, immediately desires new wine, for he says the old is better. Well, that's not clear to a Christian, because they don't know what that's talking about. But the old wine are the old teachings, and they don't want the new wine, because the old wine seems better to them. Because they don't want to receive the truth. They want to receive the men's traditions. But the wineskins are akin to the lamp. You know, you put wine into wineskins, you know. And you have to become a new lamp, a new creation. And then he can pour in the new wine, his teachings, which are the truth that will never pass away. But he says in Ezekiel 34, thus says the Master Yahuwah, see, I am against the shepherds and shall require my flock at their hand and shall make them cease feeding the sheep, and the shepherds shall feed themselves no more. And I shall deliver my flock from their mouths, and they shall no longer be food for them. See, the people that are teaching the errors are devouring the flock.
Just amazing, brother. So eye-opening.
The things that's happening now, yes. We're learning, Christians are learning that they're calling on a name that's Greek, and they want to know, well, isn't the Hebrew roots like the foundation of our faith? And they're absolutely asking the right question. And the Hebrew roots are really where it's found. And the pastors are very afraid of people interested in the Hebrew roots, because they'll see that the roots don't go down very far and the foundation is not sure. They'll get blown away. You know, because that's why I read that scripture about the shepherds. You know, the shepherds that are eating off the sheep.
They'll lose their position and their tithe.
Oh yeah, because see, to them, their desires and their possessions and their position are what they're pursuing, because those are the three areas of our lives that Satan tempts us in. And they've fallen for that. Politicians and people in high places in ecclesiastical circles, they're all very much doing their own desires, and they're pursuing possessions. And they're also looking for a position. They even have little ranks, you know, like I'm higher than that guy, I'm over them. Well, we're all brothers and sisters. We're all on the same level. We have one head. We're just body parts, you know. I'd like to think that I would be a little pinky on the right hand, but it doesn't matter. I'll take the little toe. That's fine, because I'm in the body, and if I can do something that supports the body, I'm in a foot. Boy, I'm in a foot. Oh, good. That's great, because what in the world is the eye or the mouth or the arm or the hand going to do without a foot? Yeah, see? Yeah. See, we're all important, you know. And if we're connected to the head, that's Messiah, Mashiach. Yahusha directs the body parts. The body parts can't get in arguments with each other. They shouldn't. They do. You know, but we're supposed to love the body, you know. The body is the redeemed. We're all redeemed by the same blood.
Yeah.
You know, the blood of the Messiah flows through us, sprinkling our hearts and his mind, you know. Anyway, I wonder what else we could bring up here. Loving our brothers, you know. How can you say your lamp is lit with the Messiah's oil and you don't love your brother? I mean, you have to accept your brother along with all his errors and whatever you think is wrong. They can use the letter W. They can work at a Walmart selling Christmas trees or whatever. And that gives them an opportunity. See, if you quit your job and you went to work at a big store and you sold wreaths and Christmas ornaments, that would give you a chance to teach people. You know what this is? You know, like Arnold Schwarzenegger in that movie? The guy said, do you know what this is? He said, that's a cappuccino machine. No, you could be somewhere and you could be holding an object. So you can see evil is not in the object. It's not in the wreath or the tree. Those are just trees, you know. But the objects are not where evil is. It's in men's hearts. And if you're selling somebody a wreath or whatever, you don't want to, of course. That's a pagan idol. Represents something. But if you say, you know, Deuteronomy 18 says don't do this. You know, Deuteronomy 5, have no other before my face. You know, you could tell them the truth while you're doing it. Sowing the word. Because, see, the hammer will shatter their heart, you know. Find out what this is as you're loading the Christmas tree on their car. Do you know what this is? You just paid $100 for this huge thing that you're going to go decorate. Do you know what it is? You know. Anyway. The living words, though, the Ten Commandments are at the core. And they're either something we meditate on or we don't. So anyway, we're supposed to keep the lamp oil is his spirit, and it's really a matter of inviting him to be in charge of us, you know. And if we want to wrestle with him and say, no, I don't want you to be in charge of me in all the departments of my life and the compartments, then he will stand back. He will possess you fully. But if you say, come in, I open the door, come in. And he will come in and he will take over and he will have fellowship with you. And then but don't get in charge. I mean, submit. You know, he's got to be the one that you invited in. He's not just a guest anymore, though. See, we become his possession. We're vessels to be inhabited. That's what the objective of his creation is for us to, for him to be all in all, you know. Did I bring that up at the last seminar?
I think you did, yeah.
Okay. So that's really important. So I guess that's about all there is, isn't it?
Yeah. I wanted to ask you something else, because you collect all those archaeology magazines and stuff, don't you, and read up on that sort of thing. There was a photo going around, two photos actually, this week on Facebook. There was one of a mudslide somewhere, and there were these two massive Nepho skeletons in there. Did you think they were authentic?
In that case, I did not. No.
Oh, no?
I think, yeah, that was. See, here's the thing. In a very real way, that a lot of things that were discovered and have been discovered have been kept secret. There's very real things that are there, but the media and the archaeological community has not released these. But when you see these sensational things, especially with the internet, they've mixed the false together with the true, just like they would, you know, the UFOlogy things. See, some of these things are real, and then some of them are not. And by confusion, people will just dismiss all of it, and they'll say, oh, well, it's not, none of it's true. But, you know, I was talking to a man a few days ago in the store. In fact, he carried out one of my books. And he said, he was in his 60s. And he was raised in Judaism. He's always wondered why Christians thought what they did. And I had a chance to chat with him just briefly. But he was calling his own faith, you know, and the history of the scriptures, he was calling his own faith mythology. You see, he was always programmed in a very highly flesh-minded thing in Reform Judaism. In Reform Judaism, see, it's not like Orthodox. Orthodox is much more severe and much more believing and trusting in the words themselves as being very, very important. But Reform Judaism is a lot lighter. It's very it's very secular, you know. And he was referring to the scriptures as mythology, you know, like it would be, you know, just a book, you know. And that was sad. That's a tragic thing, because when a person doesn't really realize that, then the word doesn't have the power in the person's life. But you can still use it, because the power still is there, whether you believe it's there or not. See, even if you don't believe the power of the word, and the word hits you, you're slammed. You know, because you can say, oh, I don't trust that there's bullets in that gun, or I don't believe that that laser beam is going to harm me in the least. Well, it doesn't matter what you believe. You get in the way of that beam, and you're going to get cooked. So the same thing is true of the scriptures, the Torah. So as long as we don't worry about whether or not the person is going to receive it well or not, use it anyway, you know, because the power is in the spirit that goes forth in those words that seeks to enter into that person's life. And it will shatter their heart like a hammer smashes a rock. And that's what we have to remember. It isn't a matter of our judgment. You know, we don't make the judgment, you know. We just use the word.
Yeah.
That's what Yahusha used against the adversary, you know. Because the adversary is going to use the word too, but he's going to twist it.
Yeah.
Take it out of context, apply it to things it doesn't apply to, you know.
That's well, amazing. The only other one thing was the big massive skeleton with the stone in its forehead. Did you see that one?
A massive skeleton with a stone?
They reckon they found Goliath because it had a big stone stuck on its head. Did you see that picture?
I didn't. Here's the thing. If the skeleton was intact, Goliath's head was removed.
Remember? I'm not sure if his head was attached or not. But they reckon they found it, and they're all up in arms and all happy because they've proved the story. And this big, massive Nephilim head with a big stone stuck to its forehead.
Well, it didn't just stick into the forehead or the bone. It went through the middle of his eyes. It sunk inside of his head. It didn't just lay on the surface.
Ah, well, that's good to know.
It didn't just bump him and knock him out. This thing was deadly. That thing was shooting out of that sling like a bullet. And it was probably a stone about the size of a golf ball or so. But it was a very smooth stone that was selected by David, and he or Daud, and he put that baby in that sling, and he didn't have to shoot two of them. Mm-hmm. He just went, wow, 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 and then flung that up there, just like he was killing a beast. Mm-hmm. And it went right where he sent it, you know. In fact, there's a place in the scriptures, I don't recall where it was, but it says that there were so many men that Daud knew that were left-handed. They could hit a hare at a long distance. They could hit a horse hair, you know, or a camel hair or whatever. You know, you'd hold a camel hair up like this, and then they could hit it with their sling, with the stone. And that's the accuracy that we're talking about. He was out there in that, watching those sheep and so forth, and guarding those sheep, practicing for that very time, you know. Mm. You know, it was preparing him for that very event and getting his skills honed. Mm. And he killed, you know, beasts.
Sorry. Here you go.
He killed beasts before, you know, to protect the sheep.
Mm. But that's good to know, brother. Yeah. Thanks for today, man. That's amazing. All that information.
Oh, well, thank you. And, you know, it's a good study, the lamp.
Mm.
Yeah.
So important to have your lamp full of oil, isn't it? The Torah.
Exactly.
Meditate on the word. Mm.
Yes, it is. Mm. Well, I guess we'll see you in a couple of weeks or so then.
Yeah, wonderful.
I haven't been seeing much of you, but say hello to the family.
I will, mate. Yeah.
And Chris and all of them. And, you know, when we talk to them.
Yeah, I will.
Okay.
Enjoy the rest of your Sabbath, mate.
Oh, and you too. We'll see you. We love you.
Yeah, you too. Love you too.
Okay, bye-bye.
Bye-bye. The lamp of life. The lamp.
of life. For the lamp of life. Gonna be burning through the midnight, oh lamp of light. Yahusha is keeping us out of the strife, oh lamp of light. The Torah will keep us shining so bright, oh lamp of light. We're gonna need the oil to meet the bridegroom. Yahusha is coming soon. Oh lamp of light, we're gonna be burning through the midnight. Oh, lamp of light, Yahusha is keeping us out of the strife. Oh, lamp of light, the Torah will keep us shining so bright. Lamp of light, we're gonna need the oil to meet the bridegroom. Yahusha is coming soon. Gonna be burning.